Let's take a minute and talk more about downwash and the induced angle of attack. And let's start by looking at this from the perspective of an airfoil. So here's our airfoil coordinate system, X and Y. And this airfoil is attached to a three-dimensional wing, right? So that's just a slice of a 3D wing. And the airfoil sees not first, but in general, we have a V infinity. This is at some angle of attack to the airfoil. And that's the free stream velocity coming in relative to the coordinate system of that airfoil. And in general, we say that the drag operates in the direction of the free stream velocity, and the lift operates perpendicular to that free stream velocity. Well, because of our induced angle of attack, due to the vortex sheet back here behind the wing, that induces a change in angle of attack along the wing, and we call that the induced angle of attack. So what it ends up doing is decreasing the effective angle of attack by some alpha I. So that's the induced angle of attack, and then our final effective angle of attack is the actual angle of attack that this airfoil is going to see. Okay, that's been rotated from V infinity by alpha I. And so what happens is that the local lift gets rotated by that same. So this is my local two-dimensional airfoil lift coefficient gets rotated by alpha I. Okay, from where the global lift and drag would have been computed for the entire wing. Okay, so let's look at this now as a function of z. Let's say that this is my what we're going to plot here. Well, on the x-axis we're going to have our spanwise location. So let's go from minus b halves to b halves. So this is across my wing. If we looked at the lift distribution on a wing, it generally looks something like this, okay? We know that it has to go to zero at the tips, and for a straight wing, it's probably going to be maximum near the center. And we also know that the lift, CL, as a function of z, so the local lift coefficient is equal to CL alpha times the global alpha minus the induced angle minus alpha L0. And let's say that alpha L0 is zero just for the sake of argument right now. And so our lift distribution here is directly proportional to the lift slope and then the actual angle of attack. Now alpha minus alpha I is our alpha effective. So that's our effective angle of attack is alpha minus alpha I. We can see that from this drawing over here. So what we see is that this is, you know, the shape of the lift distribution, but this is also the shape of the effective angle of attack seen, alpha effective, seen over the span of the wing. Well, the global angle of attack alpha coming from V infinity is a constant. Let's just draw that up here, and let's say that is alpha from V infinity, and so the difference between the two is what we call the induced angle of attack. So what we can see here, so this is alpha I, is that the induced angle of attack is really or there's a large induced angle of attack at the wingtips to the extent that our lift is going to go to zero at the wingtips. And that near the center, the induced angle of attack is usually less, okay? So, but it's very pronounced at the wingtips. So this concept of how the induced angle of attack is distributed over the wing in general and how that relates to the lift distribution and the effective angle of attack, and also the fact that the presence of an induced angle of attack rotates our lift vector, our local lift, slightly. These are going to be very important when we look now at the global lift and induced drag on the aircraft. Now, one last thing that I want to point out is that because this lift vector gets rotated by alpha I, the that rotation is more pronounced here near the wingtips than it is at the center. So at the wingtips, our lift gets rotated significantly compared to the lift there at the center line.